put off by how long this video is. Don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. If the video is too long for you, I have recorded a shorter version and the link will be in the description box. Psychonauts video game review. I am going to approach this the way I did Mirror's Edge. Start with the positives and end with the negatives. If you only want one of those two, then yeah, you just jump to the right part or stop the video when I'm done with the part that you care about. And if you want the full review, you will have to watch the entire video. I will not be saying all the same to talking about all the same things in both parts. And yeah, the like with Mirror's Edge, there's a lot to love, but there are also some problems. And yeah, I can completely understand if some only want one of those two. We follow Raz, a 10-year-old gifted psychic. He wants to become a psychonaut, a psychic spy, and he sneaks into this supposed summer camp, which is actually the training ground for psychonauts, and someone has stolen the brain of one of your fellow campers. And this is confirmed by Raz literally looking through his ears, and yeah, there's just nothing there. He can see in, he can look in one ear and right out the other. And some of the campers are having the same nightmare of this sinister figure with a, like, sharp, you know, finger kind of, yeah, it's very Freddy Krueger. I'm not 100% sure if that's intentional or not, but this goes in a bit of a different direction with that. The plot is quite good. The reason the summer camp is where it is that a meteorite of titanium, which is, yeah, a meteorite hit where it in the area, and I believe they then flooded the area. At first, people who lived near it were just straight up driven insane, because titanium, it really brings out psi powers and the like. And yeah, some people are just straight up going to be driven insane. And they, you know, they flooded the area so that people wouldn't be living too close to it. And then they erected a, you know, then they ended up with this island over the titanium. And there they built an insane asylum. And after a while, there were more patients in the insane asylum than there were people in the nearby town. So yeah, and the insane asylum still stands, but it has fallen into disrepair, which doesn't mean that it's necessarily empty. And yeah, the psi, you know, yes, and where we end up with the titanium is that basically it's still bringing out, you know, psi powers, so they recruit children who have some kind of, you know, psi, yeah, that maybe a predilection towards the yeah, psi powers, and the titanium is helping bring that out. And it's, yeah, there are no longer any people around that don't have psi powers, but there is, of course, wildlife. And yeah, they're affected too. So we have, they have developed psi powers. And, if you see a bear, even if it doesn't get close to you, it's gonna telekinetically attack you with a claw, and yeah, the various wildlife have psi powers, and some of them are gonna use that for attack. So yeah. And Raz is very excited to be at the camp. He finally feels really useful. He feels like he has a purpose rather than feeling like kind of a burden to his father, and brings in this kind of existentialist, theme. And he was raised in a circus, and his father, I believe, is an acrobat. And yeah, he's tried to raise Raz to be an acrobat as well. His father does not approve of psychics. He, if I recall, his own father, the father's, Raz's grandfather, was killed by a psychic, and the entire family was cursed to, that they would die by way of water. So yeah, they try to avoid water. And one of the teachers is this drill sergeant, and the various teachers tend to use telekinesis just for pretty much anything. If they're gonna hand you something, they're gonna telekinetically, move it across the, and if you're giving something to them, telekinetically draw it to them and such. There's at least a dozen kids, all of which have their own personalities, their own conflicts. There are two bully characters, and some of the other kids might try to get revenge on them. And the main bully is especially after you because you're the new kid. And he is kind of like, yeah, he doesn't want to be upstaged by you. And there is this girl called Lily who has become jaded with the camp. She's been there for a while. She's tried all the different exercises, and yeah, it's old hat to her now. And when the plot starts, she becomes really excited because to her, finally something's happening, and she does seem kind of into you, but you're 10 and a boy, so, love is for girls, right? And that isn't the only romantic relationship either. Given that you're both at camp, you never go to her pad, her lily pad, as it were. If the game makes that joke itself, I just didn't run into it. The guy who runs it is actually this really incredible spy, but he was in a really violent, psychic kind of battle, and it left him kind of, he has trouble focusing now. And so the only way that he can really focus these days is to be near the Citanium itself. So he has this underground lab where you can also meet him, and he runs the camp. So he's always, he tries to be everywhere at once and do all the menial tasks. And the moment that he's outside of, he focuses only and understands only the menial task, basically. So, he's the cook, he's the janitor, and if you don't pay attention to what he says, or if you do something that goes against what he said, he'll like threaten you with violence. It's very fun. And like when When you first get telekinetic powers, he will, you know, be right there next to you, guiding you through how to use them. And if you try to lift him up with telekinesis, he's going to say, very good. Now, try lifting something that isn't going to beat you if you, you know, if you pick it up, something like that. And yeah, it's very funny. And despite their appearance, the characters are actually human beings. I really wasn't quite sure about that, given that they you know, some of them really look very strange. This is an indie game. It's the only Mojang Double Fine game I've played. I have not played Grim Fandango, I know. I have played The Curse of Monkey Island, and, you know, I grew up on Commander Keen, the original Prince of Persia trilogy, you know, the first Rayman game, Earthworm Jim, and, you know, I will be comparing this more to the other 3D action-adventure platformers, such as, you know, any Prince of Persia except for the first two, the two medieval games, and Crash Bandicoot 2 and 3. I have not played Crash Bandicoot 1. The designs are all memorable, cartoony. This is a game that really takes advantage of how far you can go the moment that you're working with animation. And when you have a video game where, you know, there's... Video games have their own logic that, you know, stuff you can do in a game you might not be able to do in a movie. So, you know, think... In a movie, you might not... You know, if the movie keeps showing the characters using the exact same tools over and over, it might get stale, where in a game you can go through an entire game using the same tools without it actually getting old. And yeah, it takes advantage of video game logic and the fact that, yeah, you know, everything is animated, so the sky's the limit. And who says that it has to, you know, again, the characters don't have to look human. They're, you know, their color, the various, yeah, there's, you know, some of the things will, for example, be that, you know, a character might have a huge head and really tiny legs. The bully character, his teeth are all the you know, different shapes and sizes. So, and they stick out from his gums. You know, when his mouth is open, his gums are really, you know, sticking out really clear. And yeah, really fun. And yeah, you know, the surreal, the bizarre, the creepy, you know, character designs and the world. And yeah. And, you know, some have said it's very Tim Burton. It's Beetlejuice meets Tron. I haven't watched the original Tron, I know, but I do know the concept of it. And yeah, that's quite. It's also kind of Inception. When Inception came out, Spoonie said that it really should have gone crazier. I agree that it's interesting to have a movie, and in this case, very much a game, that goes crazier, but Inception, it is very much that these are dreams that you believe are real. And yeah, so the, you know, so it's that the dream logic can suddenly become clear there. This is, you know, if Inception was a lot more cartoony, and it's this thing of the world itself is cartoony, although the, you know, you might say that the most normal looking thing in this is maybe the summer camp itself. The, you know, grass is green, the sky is blue, you know, stuff like that. So it is, but the moment you get into the imagined worlds, then it gets really out there as well. But yeah. And the it won a ton of awards. Soundtrack is great and was actually released just, separately to this. And yeah, I can see why. This has very clever creative control, as others have noted, and explores this concept of perception being a reality of itself. Has very rich styles with, a lot of imagination, creativity, individuality, artistry, variety, innovation, passion, and emotion in, everything of it. It's satirical, sardonic, fun, has great production values, and handles some big themes for, a supposed children's game, trauma, mental illness, parent-child relationships, and it does them in a way that children can follow and appreciate, but not, it's never talking down to the audience. It's both visually and intellectually stimulating, and yeah, you will fight in the mind of the enemy, chase his dreams, fight his inner demons, live his nightmares. And you literally sort emotional baggage. There are like if every mind has its own like hat bag, purse, it's, yeah, various pieces of and you have to find the luggage tag that goes with each bag. And the enemies, again, very Inception, will be, these that note that you don't belong, and they will try to get rid of you. Sensors, they try to get rid of thoughts that don't belong, and you, since you are, you don't belong. Some of them will punch you, others will shoot at you. And you will also go up against personal demons. And these are very, yeah, personalized. They always fit the mind that you find them in. And yeah, if you approach water, you will see the, this evil claw, which, if I understand correctly, is like the manifestation of the curse itself. And yeah, if you go near water, apparently Raz ate less than an hour ago, can't swim, claw ate me, that whole deal. This has very varied gameplay. It's very quirky and not mainstream. Some have said that it's like Prince of Persia, the new ones, with psychic powers, and that's yeah, that's a pretty good way to put it. You grab, shimmy, and climb ledges. You can swing on ropes, jump from them. You can walk and on and jump from tight ropes. And sometimes a rope that you can swing on can also be used as a tight rope. You'll slide very swiftly down these lines and such. You can double jump. As attack, right from the start, you can punch, and some obstacles will need punching to, yeah, for you to get through them. And you can also jump and then punch down, attacking the ground, which can be useful to, yeah, I'll leave it at that. You have to avoid obstacles. If you fall off an edge, you're likely to die, although if you just fall and land somewhere that you can just move away from, then yeah, it's There's basically no fall damage that I've noticed. You have to avoid being hit and, avoid touching things that hurt you. This has very creative environments and level ideas. Always very interesting. You can lock on to enemies, which is very useful for when you get to shoot them, which you get that ability very early on, and also allows you to dodge and jump out of the way and this kind of thing, or dodge by jumping out of the way. One boss battle has a second person view, which is a quite clever way to do it. It does make it slightly difficult, but it's interesting. It's definitely an interesting thing to. The psychic powers, basically, some of them you get by getting to a higher rank, and some of them it's specific times. Some of them it's because the teachers at the camp are training you in an ability. And when you upgrade in rank, you don't choose yourself what gets upgraded. It's set that when you upgrade to this or that, or buy this or that, certain things get upgraded, and of course, the higher you get, the more impressive upgrades you get and such. And I find this is, that's a perfectly fine way to do it. It makes it more accessible. You don't have to sit down and wonder, okay, what should I upgrade? That's a bit more advanced. And I'm not saying because it's a kid's game, just in general, I personally prefer games that kind of handle that for you. I don't want to get too deep into decisions like that. Although I will admit that some of the games I've played that have decisions like that are some of the best ones, but that's not. It makes it more accessible, and I don't think anything is lost by it in this case. It doesn't feel like you should be able to do that. Now, you can use telekinesis to pick up small items and some enemies, small enemies. A number of the enemies are small enough for this, and you can use this to attack by throwing them. You can throw an enemy away and he might, die from being thrown. You can, there will be times where you can maybe pick up something harmful and throw it at an enemy or a group of enemies. You can levitate, and it doubles as your run feature. Basically, you form a ball of like psychic energy or something, and you then you run on that to and that has you running very, very fast and gaining in speed as you go, not top speed right away. And you can also float. And it's the Batman Returns floating kind of thing. You're slow, or the Arkham games, I suppose. When that movie came out as kids, we were like, only Superman can fly, Batman can't fly. No, he can fly. Didn't you see in the movie? No, that's floating because he's going downwards. I bet that he could go straight if he wanted to. And yeah, anyway, gradually lowering, and also and you can direct it at you can let yourself float directly down, or you can direct it to one of the in one of the four directions, depending on what you want. And there are these, let's go with propellers, that if you float over one, they will send you upwards. And you can render yourself invisible for a few seconds. allowing for surprise close-up attacks and the like. There is a shield function, which, you know, you have to be standing still and it only lasts for maybe a second or more, but yeah, it's quite useful, and there are also some nifty upgrades for these. There's pyrokinesis, which allows you to set things on fire. You know, you focus on the one thing you want to set on fire, and then, you know, it takes a few seconds to get going, but yeah. And psi blast, you know, basically, yeah, using, I guess you'd say, energy balls to attack at a range. And, you know, there's a total of 8 powers. And you can assign 3 of them to, you know, keys on the keyboard. And at any time, you can bring all of them up, you know, in a full menu. And from that menu, you can easily swap. You know, you just mark a power and then press one of the 3 buttons, and then it'll be assigned there. Now, you can roam freely when not in levels, and, you know, you can go around the summer camp itself and the woods around it. You know, the Tim Schafer, I guess is how you pronounce it, the developer, wanted to, you know, he chose that setting as something that children want to explore. And it should also be noted, you don't have to explore the, you know, basically, yeah, there are things to find there, and, you know, it helps flesh out the world and such, but if you want to just focus on doing the levels, I personally pretty much focused on that, then, yeah, the game doesn't force you to free roam or punish you for not doing so. You know, you might not get as high in rank as, but yeah, I didn't really, you know, go for trying to increase my rank. Like, I didn't go out of my way to not. If it was in front of me or very close to the path I was taking anyway, then I would pick the things up. But I didn't really sit down and really focus on, and I still got to a pretty good rank and got some of the abilities. You know, again, you don't really, you're not forced to fully, you know, do absolutely everything in the game. And the, you know, as a quick comparison, the first Rayman game, which I love, you do have to, like, there's a specific, yeah, I can give away, you're always finding and freeing these, I don't know what they're called, but these cute little creatures. And yeah, in every single level, you have to find, and you can get through the level without finding it. You then just have to play that level again to find. And yeah, in order to complete the game, you will have to find all of these, you know, find and free all of these. And yeah, it platforming was pretty brutal in the 90s. Yeah. The levels themselves have this really psychedelic level design, and every level is memorable, and you see the usually bizarre psyche of the person whose mind you're inside of. Now, the structure of the levels is basically linear, but it doesn't feel linear. It doesn't feel like you're limited or forced to go in a certain specific direction. It, you know, you're basically, you're taking the route that makes sense. It doesn't feel like, oh, I wish I could just go that way, but nope, I'm blocked off. So yeah, and that's always good. There, you know, probably most games have linear level structure, and it's a really good quality to be able to hide that. And basically, in order to get help from a character, you have to go into their mind and help, solve their issues. And every level has distinct art and level design aesthetic, and you're always solving the issue of, the person's mind. And to rise in rank and such, there are collectibles, and you can replay any level at any time, basically, to go get more, to go and get some from level you already did. And a level will typically end in a boss battle, which resolves the issues of the person's mind, of the person whose mind you're in. And pretty much any time, you can call up hints, you can leave and then re-enter at the checkpoint you most recently, reached. If you legitimately feel, I cannot get further here with it, I need something to, I need more supplies of some sort, you can do that. And I'm not sure I ever really got around to trying it, but I believe, for example, you can go out and heal, and there's ammo to deal with, but that is pretty much it. Now, each level also plays differently. One level might have you, doing platforming, one might be an item hunt, another might be a series of side quests. Really, before a level starts, you do not know what it's going to look like or how it's going to play. And it's also been said that level design is devious and thought-provoking. Among the levels, one has you as basically a Godzilla-type creature when you go inside the mind of something that you would think was the evil creature, but then when you get there, you are this giant Godzilla thing, and the creature is represented by the citizens of the city that you're going to, and you can climb skyscrapers, you can knock down buildings, and of course they'll send their military at you, And there's one that's this 50s suburb, and as you proceed through it, like, it's a series of Mobius strips, and it's just, I cannot really describe it more than that. Look up videos of it. It's pretty surreal. And throughout it's overrun by G-men. It's very much this kind of Red Scare. They're looking for communists, and all of these G-men so clearly do not belong, but they claim to, so they're posing as sewer workers or road workers, and they're literally just standing there with, there's maybe like road sign, maybe they have like a stop sign, and they're standing there with the sunglasses, with the, dark suit, and just holding up the stop sign. I am a road worker. Please observe the rules of travel, the traffic laws, and just, and some of them are just hysterically funny. There's a cemetery in it. And the cemetery is also overrun by these G-men, and literally one of them stands there and says in this clearly, male voice, I am a grieving widow. I do not know whether to grieve or to move on with my life and remarry. And it's just, Yeah, it's the kind of thing where, in reality, this is kind of a sad situation, but you have this guy stand there and say, and it's like, no, you're not. I can see you're not. You're wearing a suit. You're clearly not a grieving widow. And yeah, it's unreal. And they have these hidden cameras in like lawn ornaments and such. And every so often, the lawn ornament will open. And the camera will pop out, snap a single photo, and then, back down. And, cars have these, what's it called, like radio transmission tower kind of thing. And, yeah. You may go inside, an old fa good old fashioned game, like a board game or a game of cards. And hypothetically, let's say there's a board game. There might be layers to it. At first, you're just standing and you're looking at the board game, and it's like, okay, so I can kind of see who's winning and where the pieces are, and then you can get onto the board itself, and you can really look clearly, see more detail, and yeah, walk around on the board. And another layer might then have you smaller than the pieces on it, and you're now running around. And actually, if there's like a house as part of the game's the board game's board, then you can walk up to it and knock. And yeah. Now, there's one level has this kind of neon design, and you'll interact with talking dogs and wrestlers. Now, the for a few of the levels, you also get to choose the order of which to play them. The humor has also been praised of this, and it gets really hilarious. Like, there's silly humor, clever humor, absurdist humor. For example, people might say these really extreme things and then just walk off as if nothing interesting was just, yeah. There's verbal humor, puns, the health when you're inside of someone's mind is called your mental health. And yeah, some wordplay. The characters are very unique and quirky, and as you explore the camp, you'll overhear what the children are doing, and you can walk up and talk to them. And as you progress through the game, this will change. And there are dozens of lines recorded for a single character, and they are stitched together with like vocal pauses, coughs, and such. And this is of course done to make it sound more natural. And yeah, it works quite well. Again, I can't speak to it so much myself because I didn't do, but yeah, what I saw of it definitely works. And it also has some really mature humor, and there are some hidden swears and dirty jokes and such. And basically, if you don't know what it means, you're not gonna catch them. So, parents who are worried, if the kid doesn't already know what this or that means, they're not gonna catch it. And it doesn't like stick out. It's funny even if you don't understand the double meaning, usually. And there's some really twisted and disturbing material. The voice acting is all great. There are several personalities to every person since, yeah, they are mentally ill. You are inside the minds of, yeah. And one boss is like a parody. You know how some boss enemies will, they have names for their attacks, so that basically signaling to the player, this is the kind of attack, and then you have to memorize, okay, when he does that attack, when he says that, he'll do that attack, and that attack means I have to avoid it this way. And this boss will, his the names for them are these, parodies of he, they're very literal. Like he'll say overly intricate combination and hard to avoid aerial attack, and yeah, really, really funny. You can buy healing items in between levels, and one boss enemy has one of those bits where it's like you can't see where you're supposed to go right now, but in about a second you will see it. And if you don't follow, if you can't do it within that second or so, you will die. And it's one of the rare, really fun ones of those. The final level has a significant difficulty spike, but they put in a fix for it in the re-release, which it's too bad that the re-release wasn't 11 when it originally came out in 05, but they did a great job of making it not, it fits now. It isn't, a ridiculous difficulty spike. It'll still challenge you, but they did some things. And I will say, between 11 and 05, I don't really blame them for not like doing it via a patch. I'm not sure it could really have been done just like that. It was a little more, it required a little more substantial fixing. This has a profile system, so, and I always, I'm like, every game ever should have a profile system because it's just more than one person might want to play the game and don't necessarily want to play the exact same, the same profile. And maybe you just want to start over without losing all your progress. And yeah. And you can teleport between major areas at certain checkpoints. And there's at least one part where you can walk off the edge and basically, yeah, I pretty much have to explain it to really. Basically, you're standing on a square, and you might expect that if you walk off the edge of the square, you're just gonna fall off. But instead, it's, when you walk, you'd expect to be falling off the edge, but then it turns, and the, what was before the vertical that you expected to be falling past is now the horizontal that you're walking on. And yeah, I like that they did this. It's again, it's one of those mind-bending things, but I do wish that they had made it a little clearer. At first, I wasn't sure where I was supposed to go in that part. And the graphics are quite good for the time. There's good facial, good level of expression to the faces, eyes and lip syncing and such. And, all the cutscenes are in engine. I think some might be pre-rendered, but, there are no like live action ones and such. And there are a lot of cutscenes. This took me 13 and a half hours to complete, and again, this was without trying to get absolutely everything. If I went back and tried to get absolutely everything, it would take longer. And I'm afraid that gets us to the negatives. I will say, as bad as this might make it sound, the negatives, this section of the video might make it sound, most games I've played with as big problems as this has are genuinely worse games than this, and a lot of them are worse by a lot. And to immediately deal with the quote unquote argument of, excuse me, it's just for kids. Children can actually handle a lot more than, they're sometimes given credit for, and they're also impressionable. So yeah, you shouldn't use it as an out to not, yeah, it's not an excuse. And I think they did care deeply about this game. And yeah, the best of intentions and the road to, pave the road to a certain location. The plot starts slow and or late, and then when it does start, it ramps up crazy and off screen, like a ton happened during a single mission. And after that, there's almost no twist or development that surprises you. And honestly, it feels like it's essentially that, suddenly all of the plot just happens. You get a ton of exposition, and yeah, from there on out, it's just, yeah. And the cutscenes inside levels are too long and too frequent to not always, but to an extent. And there's one level where it's especially way too frequent and they're way too long, and it stops the pace dead. It stops gameplay dead. They really should have gone the Half-Life route of it happens, but you can move during it, And while you cannot be hurt during it, enemies can move just fine. So you might be completely surrounded when the cutscene ends. And yeah, that just shouldn't happen. The plot is forwarded in the videos between the levels, except for when it isn't. And certainly it's not forwarded in the levels themselves. And you might do a little detective work within them, but they really don't. The levels don't tend to connect to the plot at all. The first of them are, just tutorials, and they don't have anything to do with the plot unless. Yeah, the plot isn't that Raz is there. There's, the plot is the brain stealing. So, yeah, and other than that, it's just, yeah, I'll get to more. But for comparison, every level in the first Rayman game or Crash Bandicoot 3, you're trying to get something that the villain stole or free something that they captured and such. And for some of these games that, more plot heavy, like, this has more plot than all the basic setup of Crash Bandicoot 3, given that it involves time travel, is maybe more involved than this. But anyway, yeah, more plot heavy, medieval, The second game is obnoxious and frustratingly tough, but both of them, almost every single level, you're dealing with major events that are directly connected to the plot. And yeah, in this, almost every single real non-tutorial level, it's just a person that you need a favor from. And if you could get the favors without the levels, then you could cut those levels and you wouldn't lose plot. You'd lose world building and backstory, environment, building, but not actual plot. And that just really shouldn't be the case. It's also, I really got to wondering why the tutorials, that's Raz training. That makes sense. But most of the regular levels, I wasn't quite sure why this needed to be Raz and why it wasn't done before now. I won't give away exactly why or what it is, but Yeah, it just really seems like this could easily have been done ages ago, and yeah. There's only one real negative to progressing through this game. You have to play it. Before I get any further, I should say, this is not me bitter. I inflicted this game upon myself, although I will say that it could have been made clearer that the game had these negatives. Even, I get they're trying to sell it, but even like major reviews, they didn't always mention these things. And but yeah, I try to always say everything I feels needs to be said about what I'm reviewing and that I feel I can comment on. Where the action adventure and or platform games that I grew up on, those I've played over and over. I don't really know that I'll play. I probably won't play this through ever again. It is possible that I'll go back and try to get some, reach a higher rank. Maybe, I don't know, but yeah. And I hate to say it, but like maybe half a year ago or so, I, for the first time ever, played the first Duke Nukem game, not Duke Nukem 3D, that I played when it came out. And I had infinitely more fun playing that. That's not to say that it's a better game, but it's more fun to play. And that's a really big. Yeah. Yeah, as others have said, the game itself, the gameplay is lackluster, chaotic. The menus have absolutely horrible navigation. And this, you're not going to spend that long in menus unless you're reconfiguring controls, which I found I did several times. But it's still a anytime you have to save or load, when you start up the game, you might have to deal with menus. And fortunately, outside of like controls and well, basically the options menu, you have to use the mouse, and it's horrible. It just I don't know how I guess it's because it's from a console and they didn't do much to fix. It just I it's absolutely horrible, and you cannot use the at least not as far as I've been able to tell. And the user interface is in the same cartoony style. And again, I'm sure this worked great on console, but there are a lot of corner ones. Like, it's basically whenever you're in your inventory or you're reconfiguring what power goes on what key. And reconfiguring what power goes on what key is something you do all the time. Basically, whenever you have to mark a corner, if you're holding down the keys to mark the corner, then you cannot, then it won't, register if you press the key you want the power to go on, or the if you're just trying to pick an inventory item, it won't pick that item. But if you let go of the buttons, it might just go back. Yeah, it won't stay in that corner, and it just, I know that nobody puts baby in a corner, but it would be really nice if I could put the, marker in the corner so that I could actually pick the, and this is something you struggle with every single time you're reassigning the powers, and really, you're reassigning the powers way more often than you should. Given that there are eight of them, I'm not sure that it would really have been that much of a problem if they just... I'm pretty sure they're not on the mouse wheel, for example. That would be one way to do it. Another would be to just use the first, you know, I mean, I'm pretty sure I didn't change. The inventory you open on one, and if you want to switch to the next page, or you want to open the powers page, because why shouldn't those be on the same key? They're both, you know, they're on two. I don't see why the first four, you know, of those, and then maybe Z, X, C, and V for just selecting which power you wanted to use then, or I'm not sure it would be good to have that as the key for activating it, but maybe if you pressed one of those keys and then pressed the key you wanted it to go on, you know, basically it's right mouse, Q, and E. Again, at least it's, I believe those are the where it starts out. And yeah, it just, that would be far easier because again, it stops the pace dead when you're trying to go in, select a power, and even though you might know which power you then have to deal with if it's in a corner, the thing I mentioned before, yeah. Now, there are not a lot of levels in this. Before I get too much into that, I should note, like I said, it took me 13 and a half hours to complete without finding everything. It might take me at least some more hours, you know, to go back over the levels and just rush through them, just really quickly find everything. And now that I know how to complete them, you know, and with, you know, relatively few levels, the price should fit, and it does. I believe it's like 10 euro and such. So I'm not saying that they're asking for way too much considering the length or such. However, there are not a lot of levels, and this would be fine if the levels were basically, if it was basically the same overall atmosphere throughout, so that it was just a concentrated, you know, a small but concentrated experience of that atmosphere. But it's not. Every level is distinct, and when you then don't have a lot, you don't have a lot of different experiences in this. And again, the first several of them are just tutorials, and those are boring. You know, the fun starts when you get to go inside the minds of really, you know, messed up people and deal with their issues. And that's also, I don't really think that it needed to be, that the tutorials needed to be that long. And it's arguable that you could more or less just, I'm almost certain that you cannot skip any of the tutorials. And I think it would be fine if you would just learn it the first time you encounter each of these things, because they're not that complicated, really. It's, you know, I mean, the if it's the first, you know, WSAD or WASD or whatever, WASD, you know, and third-person game, then sure, you know, you need to get used to that. But, you know, you could do that before the, you know, if it just, it could say, do you want to play the level itself, or do you want to run around the camp a little, familiarizing yourself with the controls? And that's another thing. If when they gave you the first tutorials, the tutorials themselves, the tutorial levels, because when you get new power, sometimes, I believe he's called Ford Kruller, the guy who runs the camp. He will show up and you'll spend 2 minutes or something figuring out how to use a certain, power, and that's it. That's fine. But when you're going through entire levels of the, it's just, you might as well just, if the game just told you, you will have to be able to, for example, for now, just run around a level. Do you want to run around, the summer camp, or are you confident that you know how to do it and you just want to play the level so that we skip the tutorials? Yeah, that would be much better. And that also, the tutorials add a bunch of time, and given that they're not that interesting, if you did take them away, you would be out a lot of the length. I'd say maybe a third of the overall length is just these tutorials. And again, to compare Crash Bandicoot 3, which is, more expensive, and it's a bigger, even correcting for like that kind of thing. And it's a bigger, this is an indie title, so of course, you can't expect the same amount of content and such. But Crash Bandicoot 3's approach is to have a few different takes, each of them memorable, on some of the same basic ideas. So, you'll have several levels for a race you have to win, deep sea diving, a trap-laden pyramid, futuristic sci-fi, medieval times, and riding on a cub, like a bear cub or a tiger cub and such, and having to guide that very quickly to avoid danger. And yeah, it just, even if you took a lot of Crash Bandicoot 3's levels out, it would still be really interesting and really colorful. And yeah, in this, there's only so much, and it's really too bad. Now, as others have noted, the gameplay is, actually briefly, I should say, the levels also do get repetitive, and some have noted this is especially true if you try to get all the collectibles, and I can see how that would make it far worse. Again, I didn't replay a single level for collectibles. I didn't replay a single level as of my recording of this. But yeah, the gameplay is, bland, clunky, and not that much fun. Now, this is apparently Tim Schafer's first platform game, and someone said that, it's made by someone who doesn't really understand, how video games should work and such. Considering that, this is not bad at all. This is a very impressive first effort, if those are really the case. However, as vital as all the, positive aspects, as I mentioned before, the story, the atmosphere, the design, the character, the voice acting, as important as those, as vital as those are, the single most important thing, in my opinion, is the gameplay. If the gameplay isn't interesting, then why am I not watching a movie of this? Or, let's say you do want to make it longer than a movie and more involved and such, just like an interactive, an interactive movie or, that kind of thing where, because people say that one of the best things about this is going around camp and listening to what the characters are, you know, talking about and doing and maybe talking to them, you can do that in just, yeah, an interactive movie or the like. You didn't need a game for that. The gameplay is why you're playing a game. It's why it's a game to begin with. And part of it is, of course, that the addition of the third dimension rather than two dimension does make it much harder to do platforming games, and especially makes it hard to do them well. A lot of the early examples clearly didn't know what to do with that. This is much, much better than that. You know, this is not Prince of Persia 3D. Not the 3D Prince of Persia games, but the third Prince of Persia game known as Prince of Persia 3D. This is not, you know, Sonic 3D. And I hear that Earthworm Jim 3D is also pretty horrible. It is still the fact that the added dimension really opens it up, and with more to take in, the momentum comes and goes, or even just dies. And I'd say it is a case could be made that you should just stick with 2D in these. You know, I've only played the demos of Rayman Legends and Rayman Origins, but yeah, certainly for those demos, it's entirely 2D, and it's just much more comfortable to play. A big part of it is when you're jumping from one platform to another, it's really hard to judge the distance, the moment that is 3D rather than 2D, and just the moment that you have to guide by every direction. Again, 2D, it's just, you know, you're going from one side of the level to the other side. So if you want to go back briefly, it's left. If you want to go forward, it's right. And then sometimes it might go upwards or something. But yeah. And here, you know, even if you can basically tell what path you're supposed to take, you might still have to do a bunch of turns along the way, and it can slow you down and even get you killed as you're struggling with how much to turn or when to turn and such. And yeah, the controls really bear the marks of a console to PC conversion. Some have said that you need a joystick to play this. I never found it necessary to break out my joystick, but it definitely has problems. The controls are definitely off, and this is especially true of the camera controls. The sensitivity, even when the sensitivity is completely maxed out, the mouse, you know, using the mouse to move the camera is far too slow. And this is even with the, you know, with smart camera on. And yeah, it's just far too slow to keep up. The you know, it doesn't keep up if you don't manually adjust it. So yeah, you have to manually adjust it all the time. And yeah, this is just, it's a real hassle. And yeah, you're really relieved whenever you don't have to adjust it, when you're just only going in a single direction, or you're maybe even sliding down something so the camera can't help but follow you properly. And it's made even worse by the fact that the Psy Blast has really awkward aiming for it, and, you know, add to that the camera problems, and it's just way too slow. It's the kind of thing where basically he'll shoot in whatever direction he's facing, and again, with 2D, if you want to turn to the left, you press left. If you want to turn to the right, you press right. There you go, now you can shoot. In this, you have to direct him very carefully because of the third dimension, and the enemies aren't slowed down by this at all. They can just head straight at you easily. And I suppose that's more or less it for the shooting and the aiming. Spoony noted in one of his reviews that the test of whether a third-person 3D camera is good or bad is, you know, the worse the camera, the harder it is to walk in a straight line. It's real, real hard in this. And there are a number of situations where you are balancing atop something, and you know, when you're just walking the tightrope, it works because you can't accidentally, you know, walk to the side. You're always walking either, you know, there are two directions on the tightrope, and you're walking in either of those or standing still. When you're balancing, and again, they could just have used the tightrope approach. When the controls are this slippery and such, you really gotta do that kind of thing whenever you can. This is, again, that's something the Prince of Persia, the Prince of Persia games, other than the first three, you know, the first two are 2D, and those are amazing. The first one especially, the second one is really brutal, really, really hard. Anyway, the Prince of Persia 3D games, yeah, basically when he's balancing atop something, he is properly balancing atop it. And you can move either side, you can jump from it, but you can't accidentally step too far and fall off, which you can in this. And yeah, it happens way too often. Then there are a few times where static cameras are forced upon you, and either the directional key will suddenly shift as it pops to a new camera, and or it's just really difficult to tell which direction you're gonna go in by which key you're pressing. Because again, you know, most of the time, if you press backwards, you know, you'll actually go backwards. You know, if you press front, you know, you have to still turn them, but those are pretty locked. But then suddenly with the static camera, and again, this can mean a lot. Yeah. Then you're suddenly, you know, going in a completely different direction, and yeah. Now, yeah, mostly you are safe in when the static camera is forced upon you, but that's still not okay. You should never have trouble controlling, you know, yeah, controlling your character should never be a problem. You should never have to put in an effort just to figure out which direction to press just to move. It should be completely comfortable. The character is an extension of yourself, of your hand and your eyes, so it should be completely comfortable. And there are a few places where a room is too small for a camera to even follow you into, and you won't be able to see anything until you leave that room. Some of these rooms might still have enemies in them. And basically, the game expects you to dodge enemies, move when, you know, sometimes this can be incredibly bouncy and slippery, especially when you're using the levitation ball, which is, of course, the only way to get to a lot of places, which, you know, also sometimes when you dismount from something, there's this really awkward dismount, and he jumps far back, and it's, you know, you almost fall off just by that, and it's just, why doesn't he just let go and just land properly? It's just, yeah, because if you're dismounting and then figuring, well, I have to go a little bit back, I have to get to the edge, and then you press back, then you just fell off instead. You also have to avoid falling off ledges, and picking up moving items. I mean, you can actually you can buy your way out of having to move that close to the items, but why are they moving in the first place? Why don't they just land where they and stay where they land? And yeah, all of this all at once, and it's too much to expect considering the wonky controls and camera problems. And when you're moving fast, you really have to depend on the controls going in the direction that you're intending them to go in, the direction you're pressing, and they won't always. The very the ability to lock on to enemies and from there, shoot, then you will properly shoot when you lock on to an enemy. And when you've locked on to, like, especially useful for boss enemies, you can actually properly jump away from them. You won't just jump awkwardly in the direction. However, it'll lock on to the wrong one all the time. Sometimes it won't lock on at all. It'll just the same key also does center view, and that can be useful, but put it on a different key. I implore you, because yeah, you'll be pressing the key, and in your mind, that should definitely have locked on, and it didn't, and you just lost an entire second, and you were hit, you were maybe even killed. Also, the dodge will not always work. Now, the levels, as before mentioned, and as others have said, yeah, they are really, these really creative environments and level ideas are always interesting, but every single level, this is especially my opinion. I'm not sure. I think the other reviewer said most levels. Every single level, in my opinion, overstays its welcome and relies too heavily on a single mechanic. So, yeah. And you can get into a first person perspective, but it's the kind of thing where you can only use that when you're standing still, so it's largely useless. You can't always tell whether whether an enemy can be comfortably punched or whether proximity will harm you. And ammunition, enemies, and the projectiles of enemies all have this aggressive orange color, so they blend together. And this, yeah, there are other things that are orange in this, but that's the only place where that's a problem. And it's made worse by the fact that you can't tell, whether you're hit or you hit an enemy successfully, the camera will shake slightly. So yeah, and then you have to, of course, check your health, which again costs you valuable seconds. And or maybe half a second, but it's still too much. It shouldn't be necessary. You can't always hear enemies. Whether they're there at all, you can't always hear when they die. You cannot always see them, and you can't always tell if what you did actually hurt them or if you need to attack them in a different way, which again costs time that you can't spare. It's real easy to lose health and ammo, and it can be really hard to come by. And again, sometimes you'll be harmed and you don't even understand why you were harmed. You didn't see anything that should have harmed you. When you are trying to aim the telekinesis, I have no idea why they did that. I mean, I'm sure it worked fine on consoles. You have to actually use the directional keys instead of the mouse. I have no idea why they did this. And you have to hold down the key for using the power rather than just press, just use toggle. I have no idea what they did. And it's not the fact that you have to stand still. That's, you know, that's fine. It's, you know, stand still, focus. That's how telekinesis is typically depicted. But yeah, you shouldn't have to be holding down the key, which is just awkward. You know, if you pressed it once and then you pressed it again to send off the, you know, the thing, that would make sense. But that letting go means you put it back down, just, yeah. And then using the directional keys. Those are the actual problems. Some of these psychic powers are really meh and or have very few uses. You know, there's an ability to see what others see. I mean, this is the kind of thing that it sounds interesting, but it's really not that useful or useful that often. And, you know, pyrokinesis also not, you know, yeah. And it gets to the point where you actually kind of forget that you have these powers because you use them so rarely. And honestly, a few of them really could have been combined. Invisibility and shield could easily just have been that, yeah, have been one. And just, you know, when you activate it, if you stand still, it's a shield. If you start moving, then it becomes invisibility because you can't move with the shield anyway. And when you're invisible, you want to move. It always, yeah. And I already mentioned that the, you know, swapping is awkward. And it's also, you know, the thing is that a lot of times you'll need more than three in a certain situation, or more than three will be useful. So yeah, suddenly you're going in and switching out one of them, and then you may soon have to switch it back, and yeah. And it also really feels like 8 was an arbitrary amount that they worked towards. Again, with some of the powers not being that useful and being meh. It feels like an arbitrary amount that they worked towards rather than it evolving naturally for what made sense for the game, for what the game needed. Most of them are rarely used, and it's purely for puzzles or maybe, you know, the one time you have to use it to get to an area that's otherwise impossible to reach. And yeah, these could just be items. You know, the moment that you have a power, you want it to really be something cool. You know, you want it to be something interesting. Yeah, not just, yeah. And again, you know, compare this to the Prince of Persia 3D, you know, every Prince of Persia game that has powers. They're fun, they're fast, they're cool to use. You know, in both games, you use them, you can use them in fights, but yeah, here, some of them are just tools or counters. Again, like the shield is, and yeah, this is tedious in the collectibles, and this is, again, collectibles is a fine enough thing to have, but basically everything in the game, you're always collecting, you're always finding things and, you know, gathering them, or maybe, you know, there's not even that many where you have to find several things that then go together. That's only for the emotional baggage. And for those, we're back into video, you know, cutscenes being too long and too frequent. The cutscene of two pieces of emotional baggage reuniting is like 5, maybe 10 seconds long. And again, it just stops the gameplay dead. There's an easy solution to this. At the end of a level, have a proper, like, sum up of everything you gathered in that level. There you can put the cutscenes for the emotional baggage. You know, that's common. That's something we're used to. That's fine. And that's kind of the time, you know, yes, I completed the level. Okay, show me what did I get? What, you know, what did I gather? But to have it every single time you do it in the, I mean, they're fine, but they're not that interesting, and they're unskippable. Which really, when there's a conversation, when there's dialogue, that you can skip, but you can't skip cutscenes as just, yeah. Yeah, the tediousness of collecting reaches critical mass at an early point where you're asked to collect no less than 800. It's these arrowheads that you use as currency. You have to collect 800 of them in order to proceed, in order to complete the rest of the game. You are forced. It's not a tool. You're forced to gather all of these. And you use this metal detector kind of thing. And, you know, and really, you know, 800, you'll really want to get 1200. And, you know, when you get there, you'll see why. Using this metal detector to go and find them, you know, because that's, of course, you know, the free roaming, and then you have to figure out, where do I go for the best, you know, or look it up online, of course. You know, where is it especially easy to come by with the metal detector, and when you find the right thing, you have to continually, you know, rapid fire on the use key, which again, you know, I mean, you can put it on one of the mouse keys, but really, mouse 1 is punch, mouse 2, you know, defaults to shoot, but you can put other psi powers on it. Those are what you want on the mouse. You know, you're punching more often than you're using, but yeah, it's just, it's ridiculous that that's the way to do it. And again, this is something you have to do over and over, and you're doing nothing other than just walking around, listening to the signal, and then just rapid fire on the use key. Okay, let's find the next one. Doing this is one of the single most obnoxious and frustrating video game experiences that I've had in recent history. And I'm one of the suckers who went for a full stealth and non-lethal playthrough of Dishonored. You know, it doesn't help that the initial tutorial has absolute information overload, which again, this you could really, you could discover this on your own, or just be told or look it up or the like. But yeah, it tells you about so many different collectibles that are all just for you to collect, and really do tend to boil down to, this will let you increase rank. You know, there's, if you collect 9, let's see, like cards, I think, and then combine them with another thing, that's one rise in rank. Then there are a bunch of items, if you find all of them, that's like 4 rises in rank. Then there are figments inside the mines, if you collect 100 of those, you rise in rank. All of these, and it's all just, see, that's where it should maybe, some of these should have been combined or eliminated or something. It's just ridiculous that they, yeah. And that's, again, something that, you know, the level design is, you know, devious and thought-provoking, but it's entirely focused on, almost entirely focused on collecting. And you will get lost at times, and yeah, there are various platforming difficulties. There are a lot of boss enemies in this, and a number of them are just bad. They're far too similar for there being so many. And just, yeah. Dodge them for a while. Either do something or wait until they're in a certain situation. Then you attack them some. then you dodge them for a while again, and yeah, and this is of course where some of the rare, you know, abilities might come in. Suddenly you have to use a very rare ability, and again, you might almost forget that you even had it, and or that might be one of the only times you ever use it. So yeah, the one level might end with a boss fight, and then the next one might open with it. And this, of course, you're free to roam between these two boss fights, but again, there's not really that much to do when you're, I mean, yeah, you can, you know, be listening to characters and such, but again, I didn't really enjoy playing this all that much. Again, there are some fun things to it. You know, I mean, when the opening cutscene plays, a lot of it made me laugh. Some of it really didn't, but a lot of it did. Then you're given control of Raz, and just immediately it's so awkward, and there are such basic problems with it that, yeah, it just, and even if I did just, you know, if I thought it would be really funny to run around and listen to everyone, talk to everyone, even just the running around, the basic movement is not very fun. It's awkward. And that, just right there, it really loses a lot. And yeah, so for, yeah, if we were talking about, you know, games where, like, Grand Theft Auto, there's a bunch you can do between missions. So, you know, the fact that a lot of the missions in those games are very hard is fine, because that's just how it is. And if you want, you can be doing something else. You can practice. You know, maybe you find that you just, you know, you're not yet good enough at the ability that is necessary. So you practice outside of missions, then you go for the mission. But yeah, when there's nothing to do other than that, it's really, you know, oh, you can replay the tutorials if you want. You can replay other levels also, of course. But again, there's not that much that you have to learn from the tutorials. And replaying levels, the only point would be to gather the collectibles. So yeah, the bosses tend to be, yeah, they tend to just not be that interesting or memorable in the, you know, in their own right. The levels overall are, again, less so with the tutorial ones. But some of the worst boss enemies are really obnoxious. There's too much going on, and it's difficult to keep track of everything, excuse me, that you need to keep track of. The difficulty is very uneven in this. It will very suddenly, you know, spike, or I don't actually know the term for the opposite, valley, I guess. And, you know, others have noted, again, I didn't really do this much, but there's not that much really, there's not no real payoff to going back and clearing out earlier levels, you know, collecting all the collectibles, because, yeah, you know what, once you have all 8 abilities, and we're just talking about upgrades to those abilities, and the abilities aren't that fun to use, some of them are rare to use, you know, some of the ones that should be fun, like levitation and, you know, bouncing on that ball, that should be a ton of fun, but the moment that you activate it, it's really hard to stand still on the ball. You basically have to be on an entirely flat surface, and even then you can't be entirely sure. So yeah, when you see a tall jump, it's not like, yes, now I get to use the levitation, or I was already using levitation because it's so awesome. It's more like, oh no, I have to use levitation again. Okay, let's try. Nope. And I fell all the way down. Okay, I guess I have to go all the way back up. I would love if they put like if they allowed like a quick saving kind of thing when you're climbing all the way up something that's tall and where you're really likely to fall, if you could just quick save after every few steps so that you didn't have to go all the way back up. And sometimes falling all the way down doesn't just mean that you have to start that part over. You might have fallen off the edge as well. You know, if like you can fall really far as long as you land on something, you didn't lose health from the fall. But if you didn't land on it, and again with the wonky camera and controls, you might fall all the way down. So yeah. And the, you know, it also has inconsistent level design, and yeah, and sudden difficulty spikes. The scenery will get between the player and the character at times, and too often you cannot see what you can touch and how you'll interact with it. There are even a few invisible walls. But yeah, you know, you can't necessarily see if you can climb something, if you can grab onto something, and yeah, making a mistake in either of those cases will prove fatal. You know, you'll jump into something and you thought you could grab it and, you know, or yeah, grab onto it as a ledge, or that you would connect with it and then start climbing, and instead you lost a life. And yeah. And yeah, things that hurt you don't look like they might hurt you, and vice versa. And yeah, really, one of the things is this game has no excuse for being this frustrating and obnoxious. I'm not talking about, you know, it being challenging. Some games are extremely challenging. And from that, you know, then I think it behooves the developers to make that clear in, like, you know, because some people will love really tough games. And it's not a bad thing that something is really difficult. It's a bad thing when it's difficult for the wrong reason, or when something that mostly isn't difficult is suddenly very difficult, or vice versa. You know, it sucks when you've hard fought your way to the end of a difficult game, and then suddenly the last bit is really nice. It's not the hardest game in the world, but Prince of Persia, The Sands of Time, that is a boring final boss. They really got better at that with, you know, Warrior Within, and especially with, you know, the Two Thrones. But yeah, you'll of course get stuck on some walls. You'll fall down, you know, fall in between things where you then can't jump out of. And this is, of course, I mean, this is literally, that's something that just should never ever happen. You should never, I was never permanently stuck, but it got close. And yeah, if, you know, if you could then, you know, if that happens in your game, then you have to put in a suicide key, because otherwise, you know, what do? Just go load the game, you know, close down and then start it back up? Or yeah, that's absolutely unacceptable. And yeah, you know, like I said before, you know, if you miss the last step of a, you know, of an entire sequence, then you gotta start all over again. You know, some experienced that it was really very much a process of elimination, and I didn't really experience that too much. It is, of course, you know, and this really is not a negative, but it is challenging in and of just being a platform game. Platform games are challenging. Even the very easiest I've ever played, there's still gonna be some challenge, because it's just, that's the nature of the genre. You might say that the moment that you have to make a lot of difficult jumps from one part to another, and if you fail the jump, you die. Yeah, that leads to very difficult game. You know, my suggestions are obviously hugely out of date, but the Commander Keen games, especially from 4 and onwards, the first one, the first trilogy is a bit harder. It's also, you cannot save in levels, only between, you know, yeah, only between levels. From 4 and onwards, you can save at any time, and there's like 10, you know, slots for saving, so that really allows you to try out different things and practice. But yeah, they are difficult games, and for sure, you don't want to start with this one, for example, or other, you know, Rayman 1. You don't want to make that the first play, you know, platform, Crash Bandicoot 2 and 3. No, no, no. Find one that, you know, that allows saving all the time and that at least starts out relatively easy. You know, Commander Keen games get really difficult, but early on, they're not, you know, they ease into that. There's, yeah. Some found that the humor waned or got predictable near the end. I more found that, you know, they would try way too hard to be funny, and, you know, some gags would go on for ages without really being funny to begin with. And I really wish that this didn't encourage children to mock certain groups. And this does have anti-critic sentiment, and as usual, that jinxes it and leaves this work of talented people deserving of significant criticism. You know, this happened with Ratatouille as well. I don't think I've seen a movie or a game or the like that really just said that critics are just mean or nasty or the like, that there's no real place for them, or that they're just bitter people that didn't end up really deserving criticism. You know, Godzilla, the Roland Emmerich Godzilla movie, where he made fun of, you know, Siskel and Ebert. It's, you know, it's pretty much anything Roland Emmerich has done deserves criticism. But with that said, it's not that he's entirely untalented. Yeah, I think I'll leave that one to people who... I don't know enough. I don't understand disaster movies well enough to judge, you know. But, you know, like I said in my review of that, Universal Soldier is the only movie that he's made that I really like. And I'm sorry, that movie is awesome. You know, it's not an amazing movie, but, you know, it's most definitely not a bad one. It, you know, it has some detractors and critics. I would say it's mostly because there were so many of that kind of action movie in the early 90s, late 80s, early 90s. So it was more of a fatigue thing than that movie is actually not. I'm sorry, that movie's fun. And I am not, you know, I don't have something against anti-critic sentiment purely because I consider myself a critic. I genuinely, it's just, yeah, I'm not sure I really should go too much into. At the core, critics love the medium, and when we express frustration, which we do sometimes, this video is an example of that. It's because we know that it could be so much better, and we wish it were. And for sure, there are some things that you can say from a critic standpoint isn't that impressive, but that can still be fun or Just, yeah. And, for that, it's. I don't. Why do you feel the need to hate on critics for that? Just say, I disagree or I choose not to. I mean, yeah. Like I said, Universal Soldier, it's definitely. It's not an amazing movie. It's just. It's. Yeah. I give it like a 7 out of 10. It's pretty good. It does write what it needs to. The action scenes are fun, creative, and last the right amount of time and are spaced out enough. There are a lot of action movies from that time that just forget how, where the action goes on for too long or it's just really boring. And yeah. And this, of course, before I get it too into that, this, I should say, it's okay to make fun of the French. They're not a, they're not a minority. They have their own country, they have their own full culture, and yeah, and sometimes they do take certain things too seriously, including themselves. It's perfectly all right to make fun of the French. However, this makes them out to appear as if they are, when it comes to war, that they're incompetent and cowardly. And this is an old prejudice. If this wasn't an American game, if this was a French game, maybe, it would bother me less. It would still not be okay. This is an old prejudice and it's completely unfounded. Sure, we Americans, devastatingly bombed their cities and didn't then think that they were grateful enough for us eventually joining the fight in this, world war, which required us to be attacked first. We couldn't possibly have just been, for all that we say that we're, the world police today, back then, there weren't enough cops on the beat, apparently. So what? They were one of the first in the fight against the Germans, and they were defeated by an unexpectedly clever tactic, and having had little time to build up their military, which they didn't know that Germany was. Germany wasn't supposed to be, we can have a debate on whether or not Germany should have been banned from building up the military another time, but the situation was that they had been barred from building up their military. They did so in secret, and so the French had trouble keeping up when they realized it. So what? They fought on sans military and devastatingly affected by the war, so the opposite of us. They fought with great losses, again, the to an extent the opposite of us, and they struggled to free their own country before we came in. That shouldn't stop us from mocking them. I'm not actually American. I chose to temporarily take on that since I felt it would be a more effective way to communicate my points there. I'm Danish. After World War II ended, we, being close to Germany, took in a few hundred thousand refugees from Germany. And these were, of course, women and children, the wives and children of Nazi soldiers. We put them in refugee camps. They had enough food, water, heat and such. Although I do believe they had to grow some of their own food, but they could get by on that fine. We did, however, not send any doctors. And of course, it wasn't, we didn't infect them or anything. It was that they were maybe malnourished from during the war. They had diseases from during the war. But it's likely that most of them could have been saved. The fact that we did that is an embarrassment to the country. And because of that, I do not go out of my way to make jokes about how Germans are too stupid to go to the doctor in time. I know it's difficult to be socially to make jokes today without kicking down. I appreciate that. That doesn't mean that it's not still wrong. This is on the, you know, this is quote unquote on the side of the mentally ill, at least barely, you know, rather than just mocking them and such, you know. The characterization of the mentally ill was much less negative, much less prejudiced when this came out than today. And near the end, this gets mean-spirited with the humor, and it, of course, you know, throws together all Latino culture, and Latinos were much less hated 10 years ago when this came out. They were still a minority and an abused one at that. So yeah, again, it's not okay. And there is also some fat shaming and transphobic humor, which less of an issue back then, but still. And you know, I was willing to let it go at the very earliest, you know, like the first fat shaming joke, the first transphobic joke, and it was like, it's, you know, whatever. They slipped up once, or they weren't, you know, they didn't think it through, but then a few more came along, and yeah, hence my bringing it up. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.